We're here with a deadly duo, but they're actually not like that in real life. They're very nice guys. David and Anthony Meyer from Octopussy, who played Misha and Grisha. So we'd like to ask you a few questions, if we may. Thanks for joining us today. So I've got this vision of all these twins turning up to Cubby Rockley's house and doing an audition, but I suspect it wasn't like that. How were you spotted, and what was the audition process like?
They were looking for, they had to find twins, because it was in the story. And they were based on some French acrobats, I think, who didn't want to do it because they died in the movie.
They're alive in real life.
They didn't want to die in the movie. They were looking at everyone and everything. They were looking at twins who were bouncers, twins who were models, twins who were taxi drivers, twins who were one who was an insurance salesman and one who was an actor. You meet all these people when you go up for twin auditions. It's very intriguing.
Okay.
Eventually they got around, and I suppose we'll have to look at these two twins, Myers.
The first thing I do is remember we were called to Pinewood, were we? Was that the first time we met them?
No, we saw a couple of casting directors first.
They're
very charming girls, women. And
Debbie Williams?
I don't think it was Debbie Williams. I'm not sure that it was.
But
that seemed to work out. David's far too depreciating. You've been up for an Evening Standard newcomers.
Oh, yes,
film.
But they were looking for
and
film.
I'd just played a Russian waiter, actually, in by a play called Duck Hunting by Vampilov in the Kate Theatre. You know, things like that, coincidence like this kind of worked out rather well. And
I just don't think they were looking for actors first. They were just looking for the twins who were like acrobats or circus
Stunt
performers.
They worked in a nightclub, the French.
Or gangsters or heavies outside clubs, you know. That was the hitman kind of
The French
kind of
duo, I think, worked in a club. I think they might have thrown knives even, but they didn't. They only been stuffed into a cannon, and, you know, I didn't know. But it accounts for our rather odd look. Because they kept the costumes, which is kind of cool, and then these black wigs, which was rather strange. Really.
Well, yes, then you go to makeup and you've got these wigs. You're taken to Pinewood, and you've got a little dressing room with a mirror and everything, and a little dressing gown, and then the wig goes on, and you look at yourself and. This is a joke I've told before, but I'm afraid I stared at myself and all I could see was my mother, when she had just come from the hairdresser with her great hoop on her. I said, fine, I'm a James Bond villain and I look like my mother. What were you going to do about this? The answer is wear boots and throw knives and have a leather jacket. You know, that takes care of that. But we went along and you were faced by a rather imposing semicircle of a table of different people with notes and things, you know, and you're trying to look like somebody with a wig, without a wig. Can you look villainous?
I remember Broccoli asking that, can we look, and I kind of laughed. Mm. And he said, Tony's laughing. And I think that was probably okay, because if we immediately started going, you know, it wouldn't have been as good.
I think I did go.
Of course we're going to look. Of course we're going to, like, you know, look villainous. What
I
do you mean?
I have no idea you wore wigs. Absolutely no idea.
Of course, we love... And of course...
No idea.
Oh, it was the 80s wigs. It was that time of big hair.
But, well... Good, all credit to the makeup then, you know.
Circus,
circus performance. I don't remember thinking about it being villainous, you know. I was thinking, where do these guys come from? You know, a small village in the Ukraine or somewhere, you know, and that's they're onto a good thing. They're in a circus, they've got money, they're sending it home, you know. But of course villains are much more, you know, fun to play on the whole, and if the world is divided into the people who would want to be James Bond or want to be a James Bond villain, then happily, you know, we fall into that last category.
Yeah, of course.
Talking about the villains, I think there's a real variety of villains in Octopussy, with Orlov and Kamal Khan and yourselves. Do you think the dynamic of the villains was, do you think that was something they were looking for when they cast the variety of people that they did? Because I feel like you've got very different styles in terms of Berkoff and the sort of slightly maniacal approach. And then you've got Jordan's much more sort of calmer feel. And then the two of you, obviously, a very visual presence.
And then Kabir Bedi, yes. You're right, there is. It's a good variety, actually. It's interesting that I've played a bit of Chekhov, I've played a bit of Tolstoy, I've played Nijinsky. So I've played actually several Russian characters. And David had good experience in film. We've both been in a film in Canada. All that sort of went into the mix. I think it's probably one of the last Russian baddies. I mean, perhaps, you know, it became, because they'd been baddies for a long time. You know, it was, oh, the Russians, they are bad. And then suddenly it was like Glasnost and, you know, perhaps we had, so it became South African or French, you know, that they became quite popular villains after Rainbow Warrior was blown up. You know, well, the villain could be French, you know. But we... we were bridging that. There was a bit of Stephen was doing, you know, the old Russian whatever, and then we were doing something
but
slightly different.
He had to be
different.
A bad Russian.
He had to be a
disgrace to the Soviet people.
Yeah.
And I think that's part of the reason that they're all so disparate. That, as Tony points out, you couldn't just have, you know, Russians bad. You had to have different kind of badness according to who these people were. Yes, it used to be Germans, you mustn't be nasty about the Germans anymore. And now it was just that time when we mustn't be nasty about the Russians anymore.
Oh, okay.
So it started with Germans, of course, that wonderful Goldfinger, I'm Gert Frobe.
Yeah.
And he really started it off.
Many people have tried to involve themselves in my affairs, unsuccessfully.
Remarkable. But what does the club secretary have to say?
Oh, nothing, Mr. Bond. I own the club.
Because Dr. No, we can't quite remember who played Dr. No, you know, whatever, but that established itself quite quickly.
I need another 1,000.
I admire your courage, Miss...
Trench. Sylvia Trench. I admire your luck, Mr...
Bond. James Bond.
I don't know whether it was ever meant. Things just happened with the James Bond franchise. And they said, we'll make a film about, you know, James Bond. Then we'll go to Jamaica and we'll, you know, on a shoestring budget, basically. And we've got this guy called Ken Adam. I think Ken Adam sounds like he comes from Broxbourne, doesn't he? German, of course. Genius, absolute genius director. And you know, so the Bond, the villainous lair became, you know, iconographic. Is that the word? Iconic.
Yeah, thanks.
They spent more money probably on the suits than on the sets, actually, in Doctor No's. There was the machine that was supposed to be a dragon, had kind of headlights, and that was like, you know, look at me, Heath Robertson had put it together somewhere, you know. But the suits they spent money on, and it was a sharp move because Sean looked pretty cool. Connery was another great find. It just worked. I mean, who could have known a Scottish? I mean, he's supposed to be English. He was supposed to be stiff upper leg, you know, English spy, you know. Goodness knows there were enough of them. But with Sean had this, but his part, Mr. Connery, he had this wonderful humour, you know.
Since you are here, would you mind giving me something to put on?
And he was sexy too, you know. And then we had Ursula Andress coming out, who was also German, of course, coming out of the sea. That was like, well, we're going to have a girl, you know. Of course, all films have to have girls in them. But immediately, it wasn't a girl anymore. It was the Bond girl. And she, and then you had, what was the other ingredient? Okay, design, Sean Connery, Ursula Andress, film score.
Yeah.
And those four things just fell into place, yeah. You know, and whether they were thought, well, we. They just got the best. They got the best, and but somehow, those four things became, you know, all part of what made a Bond film, and still are.
Sure. My favourite moment in a Bond film is the end of Casino Royale, where Daniel Craig says, "The name is Bond, James Bond." And he turns into James Bond at that moment,
yeah.
Having made all the mistakes
of
falling in love and doing all the things that somebody shouldn't do.
Yeah.
And he suddenly becomes James Bond, and you get the scene coming. His hair is in. It's fabulous.
Who is this?
The name's Bond. James Bond.
So what were your... unfortunately, we never got to meet Roger, but everyone we've worked with just says what a gentleman he was, Julian Gover, John Glenn. What was he like to work with, Roger Moore?
He was delightful. He's so relaxed that he kind of makes you relaxed, as it were. Mm. He is, as you playing the bride of the backgammon with... broccoli on the set, you know, it's all very nice. But the broccoli was very nice too.
Yeah,
I had the temerity to say that when we did the scene where I try and kill Roger Moore, I said, you know, I read it, you know, I didn't, I couldn't see that it was going to be any good, you know, or words to that effect. And broccoli just said, well, you know. A lot of the films don't look so good on paper. It's true. And it's wonderful because it worked like a dream. And then, but I mean, he's the star. I will now tell the story about that scene actually, which is interesting because this is your big moment, you know. I knew it was going to happen all day.
Mm-hmm.
Indeed, all the day before.
Yeah.
And you're going, I've got to get this one right. And Roger is against the door. You do your dying scene, yes, with the dagger. This, it might not be in every kind of every cut of the movie, because it's a bit vivid for James Bond.
You
can't show too much blood. And that's for 007. But then, so Roger's had all his close-ups, and okay, can you start moving the set, please? And they start taking away the trees, they start taking away the hut.
and and there's just you and a camera and four marks on the ground. And you say, you go hit that mark and throw one leg, hit that one, and throw the final, try not to hit the camera. Okay. Are you all right for them? You get into the next scene. So this is the big moment of your life. My one big close-up in a major movie. And they are taking half the set away and half the crew have already left. I've got to get this right. Because they say that there are only two takes to go and there is a camera that I'm not supposed to break in doing it. And I've got to remember what the f*** is the line. And so that's it.
And a Russian accent.
And it's a Russian accent. And four marks to hit. Without looking at them, because you're facing that way. So that's it. So everyone says, well, what is your advice to young people? Know your lines and hit your mark is the answer. And don't let anything else going around you put you off. But I have a little story about Roger much later. Because I was the dentist and sitting across the room from me, and I said, "Oh my God, it's Roger." It's in Cavendish Square. It's good to you as an actor. You should spend enough money on your teeth. We all know that because it feels good. English teeth have been a bad joke for too long.
Yeah,
and so I went over him. I said, "I nearly killed you 10 years ago. Do you remember that?" He said, "Oh yes. Well, I remember the shirts." And I said, "Well, yes, it was in Octopussy, and we were doing that." And then maybe he thought, "Well, that was a bit cruel actually," because when I was leaving, I was the other side of the room, in the hallway indeed, collecting my coat, and he got up from the waiting room, came over there and shook my hand very warmly. Said how
what an amazing
it was
story.
To see me again, which you don't have to do when you're a big movie star. Mm-hmm. I could have, but you know, because then you just said, "Oh, yes. No, I remember them now." Yes, but he was very sweet. So that was the last time I saw him.
Oh, incredible story.
I was rung up by some guy who was writing about Roger Moore, and he said, "Now, what can you say about Roger Moore?" I said, "Oh, he's a really nice guy." I said, "Up, I can't find anybody to say anything bad about Roger Moore." He's longing for a sneaky lowdown gossip, but it's the nothing, niente. Gave me a lift in his car once, you know.
The only person who said anything slightly bad about Roger, it was a very subtle remark, was Michael Caine. You know, he didn't get noted for his acting, I have to say, when he was admiring this wonderful charity work. But Sir Michael Caine was very clear to point out that it wasn't the acting that he got his knighthood for, which I thought was
well,
charity
work.
It was a wonderful work.
Which
it
was fantastic work.
Yeah, wonderful.
Richard Harris also, I think they were doing something about mercenaries in Africa or whatever. Oh, the Wild Geese. So we discovered that Roger Moore really wasn't 007. He was sort of 003 and a half, you know. he wasn't one of the, you know, guys.
Six and a half.
Because we had
3 and a half.
Richard Harris and Richard Burton, you know, and you know they were out drinking every night, you know. But Roger was cool.
Sean.
Sean Finn. How are you, Peter?
Why would you be looking for me?
My agent was the lovely Maggie Parker for a while, whose husband Al had just died, but she was always talked about my Al. And she said, "I remember him watching Roger Moore in probably Ivanhoe or something like that." He did Ivanhoe and he did the Saint.
Can I help you, sir?
Yes, I'd like a room with a bath, if possible.
Oh, no, I haven't. I can give you room number 7, though. The bathroom's just across the hall.
7 was always my lucky number.
And your name, sir?
Templar. Simon Templar.
And he did something with Tony Curtis. But probably the first thing was Ivanhoe. And Al said, "That guy'll be a great star." And she had said, "What do you mean? You know, he's just, you know, good-looking chap, you know." But Al knew. He could see it. He could see it.
I know you're both seasoned stage actors. What kind of impact did the James Bond role have on your careers?
Well, we were twins, you see. And so you're a double. So we've got some toothpaste commercials, double mint chewing gum commercials. It's not quite true. We got one lovely off that. We got Peter Greenaway's Draftsman's Contract,
which
is a fabulous film to be in. But it is true that as a double actor, there's only so much you can do.
It hadn't worked out particularly well for a while. We joined the profession in different ways and different theatres and worked with different people. And then the first time we worked together, it didn't really gel at all. But then we did a film in Canada, which nobody ever saw. But that was very good experience. That was good experience for working on a film set, you know, because there is nothing like it. We've been grown up in fringe theatre and, you know, or repertory theatre, sort of, as it were, almost. But
we did an interesting little film of Hamlet, which was a student film, really, but it has an interesting cast, including Helen Mirren and Quentin Crisp, Vladik Shabel and Barry Stanton. A quirky little movie. There are some definitely good bits in it. But I was the, you've got to go and kill this this bad man, your uncle, part of Hamlet. He was there. I said, but it's so difficult, part of Hamlet. So the dark and the light, and there are bits that work very well.
I can remember filming that and looking at Vladik Shabel and thinking, I'm in a James Bond film. that's why I immediately thought of, I related him to James Bond films. And I think it just went on to give us kind of energy and lots of other things that we did. And I went on to study art and filmmaking, and I paint now, and I teach kids. And believe me, you know, when things are going bad with an 11-year-old kid, you tell them their teacher's been in a James Bond film. That helps a lot with the teaching, I assure you. You know. And it's sort of just delighted to have happened. As I said, well, after we were talking previously, when I said that we sort of forgot about it after we'd done it, you know, well, that's almost, you know, did a James Bond film. Well, and then suddenly, you know, the franchise has grown so tremendously that it becomes, I mean, it was immediately something you could tell taxi drivers, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, that was, you know, because they're not going to be. I played Romeo in Lancaster, you know, probably one of the greatest moments of my life. But the taxi driver's not going to be impressed by that. but say you've been in a James Bond film, that's just fine.
Anywhere else in the world, anywhere, which is nice. It's a little. Because when you say you're an actor, people tend to be, yeah, sure. what have you done? You've been in it. Yeah. They're on their knees.
The Russians apparently
have a sort of ace card to produce. But it is funny.
The Russians apparently love the Russian villains, James Bond. They really like. And I sort of think Putin, you know, is one of the shady characters of our world at the moment. I mean, I still think he'd be delighted, you know, to meet the
Putin
Russian knife throwers.
Is
in
a James Bond villain. Exactly. He is so master of the universe, James Bond. Let's face it, when you see that face. Maybe we'll have to cut that before the movie. We'll all get shot. but it's true. I think Octopussy is actually slightly more enjoyed and delighted with now. When we did it, it was the James Bond. They were thinking maybe the formula was getting a bit tired. It wasn't quite, you know, the way it was. Now they've tried to do many ways, you know. They quite like the old formula, looks a lot of the fun now in retrospect. And I still actually get, I had to go run to the loo just before a film started the other day, and the guy said, he's up the stairs. And Yeah, you're that guy. You're that dive thrower from Octopussy, aren't you?
No,
that really? Was last year. Yes.
Oh, really?
So it still happens, which is strange.
I think I've only been recognised by two owners of video stores, who were the only people that would recognise, who knew enough about that. But of course, we meet the fans who know, you know, what cigarette packet was used in Dr. No, you know, in the first, second scene, by, you know, absolutely every single detail, quite extraordinary life.
You didn't get models of the people, characters in movies. Do they do little models of characters in James Bond?
Yeah, I don't think you've been. Yeah, they do.
Do them now?
Yeah, I've got the figures at home, and
They didn't do you,
I'm afraid. Perhaps you should have a word. Yeah.
Well, it was a little while before we realised there was an entire industry.
Yeah.
With, you know, Comic Con and all the rest of it. Building.
Yeah, it was before Graham Norton and all that. You know, we could have done Graham Norton, wouldn't we? our time, we'd be happy to have done that. But it was some. It's extraordinary that it sort of goes on. In fact, it grows. You know, I think it probably has more effect on my. I mean, doing this interview or whatever. It's sort of become larger than it was for about 5-10 years afterwards. We kind of forgot about it. Just carried on doing. Well, I went to art school and I went to film school, but and the things that most impressed my fellow students were that not that I worked with Peter Brook, but that. I had worked with Stephen Berkoff and I had done a James Bond film. And in fact, one particular moment, did both at the same time. Mm-hmm.
Fantastic. So what was it like working with all those other people? Maud Adams, John Glenn, who we recently met, delightful chap, all those big stars.
So you did feel slightly that you were in, you know, part of a huge industry here, you know. And this is your first part in a big movie, you know. It's a little, you're a little intimidated. You want really to do your best for the bits that you've got, and so you don't spend a lot of time interacting with everyone else because everyone's feeling the same. And then Louis Jordan was running back to his caravan to listen to his music in between takes, you know. Well, of course, it's lovely later when you meet to sign the autographs. It's lovely because it is like a big family reunion.
Oh, well, a school reunion, really. I mean, it's like, we hadn't talked to Carina Weyburn. Joined the filming, but we were signing. Hello, how lovely to see you. You know, it's like a great reunion. You know, because the same thing had happened to everybody. You know, they realised we were kind of part of this huge family. Yeah. Kabir Bedi was very nice. I came on set without my waistcoat once. Now nobody clocked it. I know we had a continuity guard. We had a cameraman there. We had a director there. I mean, you say I didn't clock it either, but I mean, I couldn't see myself. You know, I was felt sort of quite light and happy. It was Kabir Bedi who said, "Shouldn't you be wearing a waistcoat?" And John Glenn said, "Thank you very much indeed." I would have, you know, we had had the film in the can. Nobody had noticed. I might have got back to my dressing room and thought, shooting a scene again, you know, maybe not till scene to the rushes. Okay, what the rushes?
That's so much fun on occasion. You get the continuity lady. It's not the same now, you know, but she used to have a book on her lap. Writing down the number of daggers you've thrown in the last scene and which side of the waistcoat, if you had all the daggers that appeared from the waistcoats, they would be out here, actually, you know. I don't know how we got through them all. But and she, this lovely person, was, of course, had to be tied on the top of the train for the fight scene on the moving train. And to secure, she was... Sometimes they're set in desks in the middle of swamps, you know. They're used to being in strange places. But that darling lady was sitting there saying, "It's all right for you men, you just like playing trains."
It was in the days when to see a woman behind the camera was quite unusual. And it was kind of macho setup. Of course, the lovely Emma Porteous doing the costumes. As I said, I maintain she must have remembered The Mouse That Roared with Peter Sellers, because he wears a costume kind of similar to ours. I suddenly realised it was one of my favourite films. I think she might have got that. But she was married to Peter, who was in the film, of course. Lots of family things going on. It is like an army, though, a big film, and it is pretty impressive. I would think the makeup is kind of first aid, you know, where you get kind of padded and patted. And that's where all the gossip, you know, like the hairdressers or any hairdressers, that's where you get the gossip and the stuff from. And similarly, the wardrobe and things like that. And then you have, the cameras and of course, you have the searchlights, and you have the cameras are like the artillery, you know, and the director's the general, and then you have the assistant director, the sergeants, majors, and then you have the infantry, and we all know who the infantry are. Yes, we are the foot soldiers. We are the ones that actually go into battle. But it is an extraordinary, you know, phenomena, and that is why there are several extraordinary films made about filmmaking, you know.
Truffaut's Day for Night. Have you seen that?
Yes.
It's fabulous.
Or of course, in French, it's known as La Nuit Américaine, because the American night.
Yes.
Because
sure.
and I agree, because I remember seeing westerns on television and thinking, is that what nighttime looks like in America? Because it's like it's not dark really. You can see the clouds, but anyway. It's a wonderful film.
Disappears halfway through the shoot. And they wonderful say, she's gone off with a man. She's gone off with a man? I'd give up a man for a movie, but to give up a movie for a man.
it is a wonderful
film. Who was absolutely delightful as Martin Grace,
right,
who I think he'd auditioned for James Bond the year before. He was a wonderful man, a stunt guy, a very elegant, delightful Irish, intelligent person, and he was just lovely to work with, and I remember him vividly, because we did have this little scene together, which was on the top of the train. You know, he's kind of like, he said, "Well, just come at me, David, and I'll take hold of you, and we'll sway backwards and forwards." Which, if you look at it, is exactly what we're doing.
Yeah.
But that he was just delightful and helped me all through that, you know, which was just lovely.
Because he suffered a very bad injury, didn't he?
There was a horrific injury the next day on the same space of track, you know. Happily, he recovered from that quite all right. But then some stupid road accident happened later in his life, and he's not with us now.
I think he was in hospital for about 5 months for
but
the
yes,
octopus.
He was, yeah.
5-6 months.
They overshot. They overshot. I mean, the thing about stunts is you just have to be, you know absolutely every inch of what's going to happen.
Yeah.
And I think they were on a bit of track which hadn't been wrecked properly. Mm-hmm. And he slammed into a post. That was after we'd just finished our shooting. Literally, thank you. Well, glad to say you had finished your shooting. That was difficult.
You should have got more money.
I think that did cast a gloom on the set.
They said, well, they had to show somebody's face on the top of that train, because there were three people.
Three people said, "Well, I've got to see somebody."
Come here, Biddy. Not about graduation, and you can see Roger Moore. So, but it was three people. You're going to have to show someone. And it was me. I have to say, I had always had a fantasy about having a fight on a movie train, and I can remember. It goes back to a ridiculous schoolboy thing, The Lone Ranger on television. And an episode was advertised by the fact that there is a fight on a moving train. And I remember thinking, oh, God, I watch that. So there you were.
I never knew that. You never told
me.
That
was in Edgar Lee Hall.
Yeah, yeah, I watching the Lone Ranger, the film
black and
vividly.
White, every at 5 o'clock on in the afternoon.
Wells Fargo, Cisco Kid, and the Lone Ranger.
I have to say that the
Hopalong Cassidy. Yeah,
you get a lot of people, and when one gets older, you get a lot of people saying, "Now, the important thing, you know, is not to die thinking, oh, wish I'd done that." I have to say, I can tick quite a lot of boxes, and one is fighting on top of a train in a day.
But indeed, it did feel very like we grew up in a little cottage after the war, and with an orchard. It was called Orchard Cottage, and we used to stomp across the fields and climb apple trees and then fall off because we were being killed or shot at. It was just a sort of variation of that, really. We were just continuing that, throwing knives and dying.
So how much of that was you actually doing on that train? How much of it was blue screen? How much were you doing yourself?
I don't think blue screen. Oh, well, no, there was blue screen. Yes, yeah, so the train going through, Roger on top of the train, and it only goes through the tunnel.
There's a really nice shot of the smoke going through, whatever. I remember Kabir Bedi in the DVD says, oh, that was quite risky, because we went on a moving train. Yeah, okay, Kabir, yes, my brother was, though. But it has a lovely, it has a CGI digital kind of world about it,
but that is the moving train. There's no blue screen involved in what I did and what you see me do. I did climb up in between the carriages while it was going along.
John actually
not at full speed, but it was there. And then I have one line there, Mishka, and then you had to climb on top of the train, moving. Nothing holding me there, and move towards Martin Grace. That's why we're used so lucky. Just hold on to me, David, and we'll be all right. And it was. I don't do the falling off the train.
Right, okay.
That's though we sway backwards. You see it, and then you see one of the real stuntmen falling off into
very
the wood,
good.
And
very
then I'm
good.
Picked up going through the wood into the hub.
But it has a lovely, primitive feel, as I said, in a way. That John, at one point in the DVD, I think, says, we had a stuffed tiger's head and we pushed it out of the undergrowth very quickly.
He told us. Mm-hmm.
And I think we got away with it. No, you didn't. But, I mean, you'd never dream of doing that in a movie now. But it's, rather Brechtian in a way. It's kind of, it's like deconstructing cinema, It's wonderful.
And now you say they... You can see the Skyfall influence when Daniel Craig's on the train at the beginning.
Well,
take a bit of credit for that, maybe.
It rang a few bells.
Looking at the iconic scenes that you were both in, I mean, the knife-throwing scene in the circus, how much of that was...
Never
blind
been.
Brotherly trust, and how much of that was...
Never been called iconic before, but... We did learn how to throw the knives. We had a knife thrower who was also wearing our costume because he actually did some of the knife throwing. When I heard that, I said, "Oh, that's all right then." Half saying, "It's all right. I'll go on. You can strap me if he's going to do the knife." And this, no, it's just all right. You don't have to be.
But
we have got a dummy
on the wheel.
But I did at one point. Yeah. I
but
got on the wheel and
I'm
turned
not
around.
I'm throwing a knife at him.
But someone is throwing a knife at you.
No, when you see the long shot, it is a dummy.
It's a dummy.
I was encased in plaster, and it was a rather extraordinary experience of warm plaster. And you kind of then you hatch out of this shell, and they can make a mold of you. We had a great guy who taught us how to throw these knives, which weren't throwing knives. I went to Holland Park, and there's a dead tree in Holland Park because I had a lot of knife wounds. Well, as we learned how to do it,
when you
I
see
think
the knife arriving on the wheel, which I think you do occasionally, it's stuck inside the wheel, and they're filming it and then playing it backwards.
Okay.
It's been shot out.
They tried several ways, actually. I think that's the one.
I
think that's
the
one they did.
But it's I do then I am throwing knives at a board without my brother on it for a close-up. And it was a bit unnerving because you were in the middle of a circus with a lot of people watching you. And the small kid who'd already come up to me and said, "But you can't really show photo styles." "I can. I've been learning to sort of the United." So I said, "I've got to get some of these knives to stick in." And I think I got about 2 or 3 out of 5, which was fair enough. To save face. But because actually, when the knife thrower who taught us, who is in the long shot, throwing knives at the dummy going around, he did actually take the ear off the dummy.
Yes, yes, oh, I was quite glad.
So it was like...
good job it wasn't you.
Good glad he's a, he had a sort of Apache, they call it an Apache dance, with a girl's, his girlfriend actually, so who he threw knives at, you know, on the stage.
I remember it was the Gurkhas who were told that they would be dropped and to behind Demonelli lines with their Gurkhas and whatever, and they would be dropped from 3,000 feet, and they said, "Oh, does it have to be 3,000 feet? Can we?" And then they said, "Oh, if we have parachutes, it's all right. It could be that'd be all." True story. It was an extraordinary moment in the circus because there was a dummy, there was you, there was really me, there was James Bond in the costume, and there was our knife thrower who was in the costume. So I think it seems we're in the film a lot more than we are, actually, because, A, there are two of us, so, I mean, I hardly say anything, but, you know, it's like, well, I would, you know. And then Roger
People
Moore,
get confused, where's our
costume? So it seems like, I think it seems like we're in it for longer than we are, in fact.
Yeah.
I'm not complaining.
People get confused. They say, "Yeah, you were shot out of that cannon in the sun." No, no, that wasn't. Yes, you were. I remember it. It's kind of like...
So I'm going to mention a dirty word now, never say never again, which we asked John Glenn about. Johnny asked if it was feeding into the work he was doing. And he said, not really. But what was there any conscious that Sean Connery was making this other Bond film when you was on set? No,
there wasn't. No, there wasn't. I mean, even as we read about it, it didn't seem to go into the set, you know, that because it was such a complete world of its own. It may have added a bit of energy to John Glenn. I don't know. He's like, "Well, we'll show him." You know.
Sure, where else would a bomb be?
So, no, short answer, no, to that question. No stories attached to it at all. Nobody got drunk and started throwing plates around and talking about, you know, Sean Connery and this or that. No.
Okay.
So, sorry about that.
No, it's a great answer.
What's your opinion on the modern output and, you know, the Daniel Craig tenure?
Oh, I think it's just fine, you know, just go on. I mean, really interesting casting with Daniel Craig, quite alarmed some people, you know, but basically he'd done very interesting kind of quirky work, you know. He was in Cold Blood, wasn't he? I mean, you know, extraordinary films he had made, you know. And he's taken it really seriously, and he's taken it to another level. And obviously they had to compete with the Bourne conspiracy or whatever, and they've got... Sam, who is a real stylist, you know, really chic, really beautiful. I'm not sure Ken Adam would have approved of the Scottish hideout in the first one. It's not in Scotland. Yeah, you know it's not in Scotland. It's just not in Scotland. I'm sorry, as an art director, I kind of balked at that a bit. But no, really good stuff, really good stuff.
And so what are you guys up to now? I know you said kind of Bond has been a bit of a gift that's been given to you in recent years. What do you guys get up to now?
Oh, my goodness. After 70, you begin to think, I wouldn't mind a little bit of a rest, actually. I mean, since James Bond, done an awful lot. I was involved with the Globe Theatre for a long time, in the Globe Education, just before it was built, while it was being built, when it was opened. Seeing the new century inside the Globe Theatre, which Mark Rylance had festooned with candles, with a little meditation space at the top and the Thames flowing out. You didn't want to be anywhere else in the world for the change of the century. So I've always been very lucky in just being involved with terrific institutions and productions and working with extraordinary people. Just recently, I've been looking at the past work we've been doing. Two of the main people being with Peter Brook's amazing Midsummer Night's Dream production, which was on a white box with swings and roundabouts. It's kind of the most famous production ever of Midsummer Night's Dream. And Tony and I were both in that, which was extraordinary.
There's a poster for it upstairs. You would get a shot of it if you like.
Ein Sommernachtstraum, in German. People still talk about that and want to talk about that. And I've been disseminating pictures of it because I bought a camera in Japan and I took a whole lot of pictures from the wings of a performance, which I shouldn't really have been doing, up in the towers. And people now look at them and say, they're amazing! So I've been sending them all to Peter Brook in Paris, because there is no record of the whole entire production. And then I also worked with an amazing person called Lindsay Kemp, and he died last year. And there's been a great deal of looking back. He was a mime artist, and amazing with makeup and movement on stage. Who taught David Bowie all about?
Oh, right, okay.
Transformed David Bowie into a star, actually, because before he met Lindsay, he didn't quite know how to project the
and Kate Bush, he taught. Being. Kate Bush went to
and
his
Kate
classes.
And Kate Bush went to his classes too. There's been a lot of looking back at that and thinking, oh my gosh. So I've been doing too much looking back just recently. But actually, I've been appearing on several little stages recently. I am gay and have not always been performing very gay, like playing a villain in James Bond. You might think it's the campiest thing in the world, but but actually, it's not the first thing you think a gay fellow do. So I've been doing quite a lot of interesting little gay parts in I'm the Older Gay Man in new plays written by very talented young gay writers, which I've enjoyed very much indeed. And it's entirely different from.
Yes, nice to see that, because you were very pretty. Well, we were both very pretty in our young boy. And so you did no shortage of that when you were younger. And then, you know, like as in many women have it even worse, you know, there's a certain moment. But now you're a very good uncle or father or
yes,
grandfather.
I don't
now.
Take
yes.
my clothes off anymore
yes.
on stage.
No, exactly.
I have the dubious reputation of having three Shakespeare movies, all of which I appear with no clothes on. And I think that's...
Yeah, we've been in what's known as the Naked Hamlet, actually. Art directing, which I've done a bit of for Philip Saville, and we got stuck in a room which got very hot because in the middle of summer we hadn't expected that, and we blocked out all the windows, and I said this is like when we were filming Hamlet at the RCA with Helen Mirren and Vladek Shabel, and you know, and Philip said yes, but you didn't have any clothes on. But I studied film. I had a little short film in the West End, and thought I'm not sure I can carry on with this because I thought I'd get away from all the as a maker of films rather than just a performer. In fact, you're just talking to the same different sorts of people, asking for money and jobs and things. And I was drawing a lot, in terms of pictures or stuff that I needed, and I realised. That's what I really enjoyed. So actually, I've been to art school. I think of myself as a painter now, and I've got a little studio which I've just been doing the floor actually, scrubbing out a lot of paint and polishing it with wax. It smells beautiful. Because last year I had a hip operation, and that sort of put me out of action for anything, really, for about a year. Kind of interesting. Andy and me. I mean, Murray said it's actually life-changing.
Oh, of
you
course,
know, it's yeah. a small, it's apparently a small routine operation, but it's not. It's a. And it was like, oh, this is kind of interesting. And it's like a little... little rebirth, you know. So what's the space? Because I'm even beginning to think I could play a bit more now, you know.
In a Bond film, maybe? Another one?
Indeed. But of course, we'd have come back like a shot, but I think...
It would be one of those... Alas,
we are both dead, but...
It would be one of those villains who just sit in a big chair and smoke a cat, drunk a cat quietly, not jumping up and down so much.
If Barbara Broccoli watches this...
There's a little, yes, a little audition. I had a hip operation too, very well. Also, because I used to do all this jumping up and down on stage too, hence and on top of trains indeed. I just learned that actually I had a hip resurfacing, which was a very new thing, and they called it a Birmingham hip. That's just what Andy Murray's had too.
Oh,
they were talking about it. I haven't heard the word Birmingham hip mentioned, but it was a mention on TV this afternoon. And I wasn't really listening, and I thought, but that's what I had, and I turned it up again.
He's moving better now than he was before the hip hop. I always thought he was kind of rather gangly and kind of like a brilliant tennis player, you know. But it was like sort of a bit awkward, his movements.
He wasn't graceful, he didn't have a wonderful Nastasia or Rafa
kind of, you know. Now he's sort of smoother. And, you know,
so if you're tennis fans, you were in the right Bond film.
Sorry?
If you were tennis fans, you were in the right Bond film.
Again, a bit of fuss about that. Equity, who knew?
Equity didn't like him.
But, you know, it worked. It worked. And he was a lovely man.
Game, set, and match.
And I have to say, at least he was Indian, you know. It wasn't, you know, it was only 5 or 10 years before that where you would have, you know, white actors blacked up in films, you know. Pretty horrific, extraordinary to think that, you know. At least he was wonderful, you know.
Here, Rupia! Easy come, easy go.
Brilliant. I think before we sign off, one quick fire question to both of you. Octopussy aside, favourite James Bond film?
From Russia We Love.
Oh, really? We met the woman who massaged in From Russia With Love. I got a picture from her the first time we went, because I remember that they appeared in the Sun, the Express, as a little. That was our first introduction before I read the books. They were little cartoons, and we read Dr. No or whatever, and then there was this woman who did massages. You know, that seemed really sexy. Oh, The Living Daylights. I think I would say.
Great choice.
Yeah.
Here from Yorkie. Yes. I got the message.
Yeah. Talking of, there's the keeping you in curry line in Octopussy, which is probably very much of its time. You probably couldn't say that in a film now, could you?
Absolutely not. And I think Moore would be the first to be a bit embarrassed about that. He was throwing money out at sort of poor people in India too. I don't know whether it was in Octopussy or in another film.
You do in old James Bond movies that you can't say or do anymore.
For sure.
Patting scantily naked ladies on the behind as they exit the scene is not approved of anymore. No, it really is. Yes, you have to rethink it a bit.
No, it's just interesting that kind of maybe a bit stereotype in India.
On the other hand, I think it's shown on the island, you know, every night in the hotel. We should go there, and you know,
We really should have a free Indian holiday.
I don't think they mind. You know, I don't think. But that's curious. Well, we get into the colonial history and stuff like that. It's a bit like cricket. You know, I mean, you know, cricket and James Bond. It's like, you know, it's okay. They're extraordinary history now of James Bond's coming in and out and the different kind of different patchwork of differences and what's going to happen to the next one and so on. And as I said, it all began with that extraordinary package of Dr. No, which was, you know, I don't think anybody dreamt that anything like this could happen, you know. But it fell upon those four things. As I said, the design, the Bond girl, Sean Connery, along with Jaws, you know, theme, that's probably the most recognisable theme tune in the world.
James Bond itself, of course, you first came across long before you came to this world in a cartoon strip in Daily Express. I remember Dr. No coming out on that. And then, of course, the Pan paperbacks. I like it. Which were the sexiest things you could read at that point. And they would always end with a very sexy line, you know, for the one chapter as he slid gracefully into the bed or whatever he was. I remember the line of one last chapter in Dr. No. A caterpillar comes across him and he brushes it off and he stamps on it and it burst yellowy. That's the line I remember from a James Bond book. But that's what you got the excitement
for. It was an interesting before. Well, no, the film came out, didn't it, too? And I rate it with the Profumo Affair and the wonderful documentaries, who made them? Ken Russell films, which we saw.
Those three breakthrough things, really,
which were the beginning of the 60s, you know.
Yeah, and of course you mentioned From Russia With Love, and Robert Shaw was such a fantastic henchman. I was just wondering how you approached the roles. Was there any inspiration from previous henchmen or...?
Should have been, there wasn't. No, did absolutely no research whatsoever, I have to say. not really, just trying to get an accent, or finding a Russian accent was one thing.
How scary was that, kind of, getting that accent right, was it?
I kind of
disagree. I mean, the main thing is interesting working as twins. I mean, you know, we had to actually, you know, think about, you know, you enter an imaginary world as an actor, you know, and then here we are actually not, because actually a lot of my acting before had been getting away from being a twin. I'm not. I'm a king. I'm Romeo. I'm Hamlet. I'm, you know, and lo and behold, no, I'm a twin. And I thought, actually, I didn't go into acting to be a twin. I went to, you know, but that was kind of interesting. I certainly thought about, where we came from. But as I said, should I really, James Bond? It's not Brecht, is it? It's not Shakespeare. It's not agitprop. It's not, you know, it's not serious. On the other hand, Lotte Lenya, you know, was a wonderful villainess in From Russia With Love. And I did, she'd worked with Brecht and Kurt Weill and a bit like Peter Lorre, you know, well, that's okay. You know, if she did it, I think she was a bit of an inspiration, I must admit.
Sure. Well, guys, it's been an absolute pleasure to talk to you and to listen to your story. So on behalf of everyone at Football.
Likewise.
Thank you.
Likewise, Joe.
Yes, we didn't get talking about actually working as twins. There was one moment where twins, we were suddenly like, oh my God, the Meyer twins were hot, as it were. You know, but you had to go, I remember at one time going to the draftsman's contract audition, and he said, yeah, we can get this. and you just sat there, and you only had to cross your legs at the same time, very well. Like, and playing a twin was something you could home in on, because you know, as two fellas, you spend most of your life trying to assert your own personality.
Yeah.
And then suddenly you through a process of osmosis, you could actually play a twin. And as you played twins, you became more alike and all the rest of it.
Yeah. Yes, it's been a nice journey. It's interesting, as a part and a role that you're thinking about. And then there's actually quite kind of personal journey that we were doing. And as I said, sometimes it didn't work out. You know, the film in Canada, goodness, we were both doing completely different things. And we didn't, you know, work. But now, you know, can't really complain. You know, of having a twin brother as an actor, because you know, James Bond. So I mean, thank you, James Bond.
There's a great moment in when you're chasing 009, when you give each other this look after you've thrown the knife in his back. I just think that's a brilliant moment where you both look at each other. And it gives a kind of insight.
And probably not intentional, you know, that's not calculated. That just happens, you know, because we're twins. And both in, you know.
Ever since we were born, kind of thing. Mm. Yeah.
Mm. Okay, guys, thank you very much.
Not at all, guys. Well done, Ben. Right. You got all that?
Got it.